Townsend. Hi, yeah, this is Chris.
Hi, Chris Finn.
That's something that's off into
Chris Walken. Yeah. I did the show a long time ago.
God, I look nasty.
I think men should be angels too. I don't know why that can't be the case.
Leave a shot of you like this, just like landing like this, hand on hair. It's the whole room, it's just like insane.
It's me, everybody!
Hey!
One word, energy.
Hey! I like the little sauce!
I don't think I could love a human being as much as I love McGee.
McGee is just this dervish of energy.
All right, I gotta see the Bosley coverage. Let's go.
McGee is probably the most enthusiastic person I've ever worked with.
Great.
Super enthusiastic.
All right.
McGee's amazing. There wasn't a day this guy didn't put it all out there.
To the last day we finished, he was applauding after every scene.
All right!
He never, ever lost that enthusiasm. He had a joy about the film, and a joy about making the movie.
It's such a good-looking shot.
He'd be like, yeah, this is the best scene ever. This is the best shot ever done.
Yeah, Diaz!
He loves what he's doing, and that kind of enthusiasm will seep down to everybody.
How about it, everybody?
Which is so catching, like a sort of glorious disease. You get G'd up.
Right on!
Yeah. He kept the crew going, the actors going, and that's like the best thing.
You guys, it's so good.
He drove us to be tougher and smarter, and his belief in us made us work harder and be better at our jobs.
Exactly, exactly that.
And I loved his direction, you know, whether it was like, I want pure Discovery Channel, all of a sudden I'd be like, I get it.
Skewer her, you know, just Ben-Hur javelin style.
If you put a nickel in McGee, he will do the entire movie, shot by shot, from start to finish. You can ask him a question about any scene 45 minutes in the movie and just say, what about this? And he goes, we open on, and he starts from the beginning and goes all the way through the whole damn thing. It's like he's plea bargaining for his life.
And then you run out and you kiss Pete and you split.
The really cool thing about McGee is that he knows what his destination is, but he's totally open as to how you get there. This is the most collaborative film I've ever worked on.
And we go in on the Thin Man. Yeah. No problem.
Yeah. I could come and talk about the littlest idea, and that he would have all the patience and energy and time in the world for it.
If McGee's in an elevator and it stops at a floor before it gets to the lobby, he will tell that person entering the elevator, shot by shot, the entire movie.
It was really about everybody coming together and making a movie together, which was a hell of a lot of fun.
Did you ever see Manchurian Candidate? Yeah, I think there may be some sort of thing that any kind of trigger just sets him off. He does the whole movie over and over again like that.
I think he's got a wonderful eye. If I'm not actually in the scene, I try to kind of lurk behind the monitor, see what he's doing, because I'm fascinated. I love watching him work.
He is an amazing visual stylist. I mean, he really comes from that school of telling the story visually, and his frames are just so cool.
His vision of the movie was so great and so much fun, I was immediately won over. He had a very, very sure sense of visually what he wanted to do and the tone for the film.
Cut it! All right, we gotta get a little more stillness out of the background, we'll be good.
I just found myself sort of naturally more drawn to the stuff that's more celebratory and just explosive and colorful and exciting and funny. It's fantasy, it's theater and film is fantasy and just sort of a bit of escape. Charlie's Angels is never going to be Othello, and as it shouldn't be. It's a fun, just ode to joy kind of Papa Wheelie kind of movie. I mean, you got Drew, you got Cameron, you got Lucy, you got Bill Murray, you got action, you got color, you got California, you got bikinis and speedboats. I like split screens. I think about the Bond films. I think about Austin Powers. I think about The Matrix. I think about the great MGM musicals. where you see these films that were shot in Technicolor, and they just look so rich, and they've got so much color, and it's so velvety, and it's so luxurious, and has so much depth, and I just would say to myself, why can't they make films that look as beautiful as that anymore?
What G told me was, this isn't reality, this is angel world, and they have this bubble around them that is a very colorful world.
There's a scene where Natalie is dreaming, you know, just the color palette of that, I just wanted to be very syrupy, heavy, velvety colors all around the edges of the frame, so your eye would go right to the center of the frame, right to her. The racetrack, for example, the Angels, of course, surprise, surprise, have this, you know, American flag, red, white, and blue race car, and their suits are boldest blue, and so there's a scene where the girls are rocking out in like a rock and roll band, we're using gigantic American flags, we have, you know, the red, the white, the blue just pumping, and the girls have sparkly guitars and clear plastic John Bonham drum sets.
We wanted to take every element of filmmaking and just turn it to 11.
That's a cinematographer's dream, to know that one has tremendous freedom to experiment with texturing one scene as a blue scene and then just hopping over and doing a scene in the red.
We just went for as much sort of just impact and just punch as possible.
What's McGee's real name?
It's like Donald Rosen or something like that.
Overall, when you say his name, you can't not smile. And his positivity kind of took us through the whole movie. I think it was an honor to work with him.
He's Joe McGinty. No, McGinty's his middle name.
I have a love and a loyalty towards this man because I continued without doubt to trust his instincts.
Maybe he's hiding from something like the Lone Ranger. I don't know what the story is.
Yeah,
The fighting.
Wow, can you imagine Drew and Cameron and Lucy fighting in this capacity? It'd be so sexy. And it'd be so exciting. This is what we gotta do. We gotta do this.
Chun Yan, who, you know, we all refer to as the master, because he's certainly a master of designing martial art film.
He and his brother Wu Ping, who did, you know, The Matrix and came up with Jackie Chan in the 70s in Hong Kong cinema.
When we met with Chun Yan, we were so excited about his particular style that it had to be Chun Yan.
Oh, yeah!
In the beginning, when he first met the actresses, he was quite concerned. And I thought there would be a lot of difficulties.
What he wanted out of the cast was not money first, but was commitment.
Because you can't go halfway on this. You want us to train you, you have to commit to it. I'm down for that. We're like, absolutely, we'll do it. Training starts off as like you think that you're going to become a kung fu master because you're being trained by these kung fu masters. But really what it is that they're just conditioning you.
And that means the basic strength training, flexibility training, and then the wire training.
They worked us for 3 months, 8 hours a day.
5 or 6 days a week.
Which is so long, the days are so long.
They were really, really put through the ringer.
I emphasize in Chinese, it's called eating bitterness, which means go through pain, be tough, be strong. And they were willing to eat the bitterness.
First day I was like, excuse me, something you need to know. I can't touch my toes. And of course, by the end of the day, my forehead was down on my knees, just crying, just literally crying tears.
So how do you feel, drool?
You have to stand in horse stances where you're, you know, bent down on your knees and you're balancing all your body weight.
Definitely been very painful, extremely painful experience. I can barely move my legs now. You know, I was more flexible when I walked in the first day.
Your knuckles would be broken with bloody vessels, and you just thought, yeah, that's so hot. You sweat, you bond, you learn things that you never thought that you could do.
And it was amazing to see that transformation, not only, you know, through yourself, but seeing Drew or Cameron suddenly doing something that we've been trying to do for months.
Improvement was much better than originally expected.
We'd do photo shoots where it'd be like, Drew, you know, let's see a kick. And here's Drew Barrymore, who you think, you know, Drew Barrymore, fuzzy animals and cuddly toys. And you just see all these like big burly grips kind of stand back like, holy shit, look at this girl, man, she'll kick your ass.
Drew is a barroom fighter. Cameron is fantastically elegant. She's very fast with her moves and her spins and everything else. And Lucy is a mixture of the two. They've all got their own sort of threat.
they catered to that. They saw what we were capable of and gave us those things to accomplish. I wasn't so great at the kicks. I was good in the wires.
Over the years, the Hong Kong people have developed this art. It has to do with the legendary traditional Chinese literature where there are a lot of people flying around, jumping up and down. So to match that imagination, they developed this art.
It's all wires. People are like, you jump so high in the air. And it's like, yeah, you jump, but you have a little bit of help. You know, it's three guys on the other end of a rope pulling you up like this.
Let's go, bitch!
There is a scene where Drew Barrymore, she had to kick two bad guys.
King Kong palm.
Action! Help!
We filmed probably 20 times, and each time was so painful for her, but she kept on doing it.
Anytime you fly somebody, it's uncomfortable. And I'll tell you, we never had any complaints.
Is that comfortable, bro?
Feels so good.
The very first day when we were doing martial arts stuff, I had this freaky flashback to my dad, who was like a football coach and sort of a disciplinarian. I'm like, Barrymore, you will perform like a champion today.
All right, Lucy, really dig into it. Dig into it.
Chun Yan is so quiet and reserved. And just kind of would, like, you know, go up to the girls and just speak to them very quietly. And that would, you know, have infinitely more impact than me, like, doing cartwheels and, like, trying to get them all fired up.
Yeah, kick me, face it, you hear, you go over there.
What? I mean, I was just, like, all pops and clicks, but, you know, fortunately I had Chun Yan to go in there and make it happen.
Yeah!
Shooting the stuff with wires is very challenging because you can only get very small bits at a time.
Cut! Woo! I love that!
It's nice having the experience of Chun Yan sort of standing over your shoulder. We shared the same passion for ultimately getting it exactly where we knew it needed to be.
Right.
If Cameron, you know, needs to kick Crispin in the chest, he wants perfect extension out of her leg and he wants the toe pointed this way instead of pointed this way because it's more beautiful and more correct and respectful of the ancient traditions and arts, and these girls gotta look beautiful and kick ass.
He's very tough on them. He makes them do tons of takes.
You wouldn't move on until he was happy. Yeah, you'd have to get the okay from Chun Yan.
One more, let's go again.
And he even said before we started, when I say we need to do it again, you need to trust that we need to do it again. But when I say we got it, you have to trust that we got it.
Just sort of his response when it goes right transcends any language barrier. Because you see him with this big smile, like this big thumbs up, and he starts clapping.
And then when he finally gives you the thumbs up, you know it really means something. You know you've done something well and you've made an accomplishment. Good? Good. Coverage, man.
And I'm just very pleased with the performance that they have.
For him to say that to me, like, him, who they don't give compliments.
I just have such high respect for him. We've brewed to be very close with them too, and they're so wonderful, and I can't imagine having done this film without them.
We became a very tight family, very harmonious.
I just felt so tough and strong, and it was just thrilling to me.
It's very impressive, and I was jealous because I wanted to learn all that stuff.
Never send a man to do a woman's job.
It is about girls having fun, you know, and I really do respect that whole Cyndi Lauper ethic. They're just having a blast.
It's an opportunity of a lifetime. That's the great thing about making movies. You get an opportunity to do things that you never would have been able to in any other circumstance. Every day you go to work, you're like, I love my job.
And that's kicking your ass.
There's the world that you and I live in, and then there's the angel world that has its own rules.
An extra beautiful place, a heightened reality that was ultimately grounded in reality. Each scene, you know, had its own signature. I wanted it to feel like a gigantic storybook where you were turning pages. You remember the scene at the racetrack. You remember Cameron's dream. You remember Lucy inside of a chrome Airstream trailer, the Swiss Miss Yodeler scene. You would never confound this page with the current page with the page that's about to follow.
So that gives you a certain freedom to go all the way. We decided at the very beginning to try and hit a style cooler and sillier and Saturday morning cartoonish, which was fun, not so high style. And colors were fun and joyous. And we talked about reds, and we talked about golden yellows, and we talked about monochromatic sets. And so we hit a tone that we knew right away which was there. And it wasn't something that we'd seen before.
to recreate the towns and agency, but not like what you saw in Charlie's Angels. It was a fun and very difficult task.
So I took the basic floor plan and said, well, what would have happened? What would have happened was that Charlie, even if he never shows up at the place, he would have called the decorator and said, go down there and fix my place up. I'm tired of this old crap. We put modern art on the walls and the couches became really stylized and cool. Everything took on a really wonderful, clean look.
There were some similarities, like the screen that comes down out of the ceiling, but it was all brought up to present time. Excuse me, I have to take a phone call.
Good morning, Angels.
Good morning, Charlie.
That's the essence of Charlie. That's the embryo of Charlie's Angels. And I just want the speaker box to be reminiscent of home.
We searched out that particular model and brand of speakerphone. I called one of the prop houses, and they happened to have the speakerphone. So we found what we believe is the original speaker box from Charlie's Angels, the TV show.
Dylan, Alex, Natalie, I hope you're rested and ready for your next assignment.
The Chinese Alley we did all on stage, which had backings going all the way around it. It was three stories in some areas.
Well, we originally were going to go and shoot that at Universal. They have a little alleyway, which is great. And then I saw the rental, what it would cost to rent this place. I can build this on a stage for three quarters of that, but at least they'll have the facility shooting at the daytime, they'll have control, they won't have to worry about weather and all that stuff. In the set itself, we stylized it a bit, and it became very close to what originally had inspired us, which was West Side Story.
To me, one of the most interesting set was the Knox residence. We wanted to look into a John Lautner style of architecture.
Even though we didn't have much time, we knew we had an opportunity to make it really special. It is the kind of play toy that a kid who's just done a dot-com company would buy, because it's cool. It's a great chick pad, real 50s, 60s modern. Big, huge panels of glass. Each one of them was a different size and a different shape. And surrounded by trees and this beautiful landscape out in the south, which is downtown LA. We did a very large backing. I think it was 160 feet by 35 feet. And we put on maybe 1,200 little blinking lights.
I would go there every day and I'd look around at the stage and I couldn't believe it. It was a set. I couldn't believe it.
We had great fun with sets like the mainframe where Natalie breaks in.
Very stylized, very high-tech. You didn't know from one room to the next what was going to happen. Borderline James Bondish kind of feel.
The other part of Red Star was the outside of the mainframe. I had designed this circular hallway. Then McGee had this idea of the bathroom. And as an homage to Stanley Kubrick, it is exactly the bathroom in The Shining.
I hope you like to dance.
Are you kidding? I love to dance.
The Soul Train set was McGee's idea right from the beginning. He wanted Soul Train. That was it. He wanted Soul Train.
That was fun. It was using the existing Soul Train. And we added a few things to it. We added a lot of red.
I wanted it red, because I wanted it red hot. I wanted lacquer, and I wanted flashy, bright, vaudeville, winky-blinky style lights. It says Soul Train, Soul Train, Soul Train.
So we went in, and I made this giant Soul Train sign with the lights. Of course, all of that means nothing, because Cameron stole the show with that.
It's just great when you have somebody on your team who you can just give a few words of description, and they just go for it, and they make you look good. Proof's in the pudding and up there on the screen.
That's a very nice costume, young lady.
What do you find most engaging about the Three Angels?
Their wardrobes.
I mean, the emphasis clearly in a Charlie's Angels film, the angels gotta look absolutely extraordinary.
They look damn good.
When they are as casual as sort of t-shirts and jeans and doing their sort of surfer girl thing, or when they have the red sparkly dress, or when they're in wetsuits coming out of the ocean, or when they're in, you know, the pit suits from the race car scene, they always need to look their best. And, you know, Joe Alesi convinced me of the importance of taking each lady for who she is.
With the original show, the three girls were quite similar in terms of their body types. Our look is much more individual per actress than I think maybe the original was.
Once upon a time, there were three very different little girls.
Cameron's, we sort of went with a California, very fresh, spontaneous.
They don't call me Balls Out Natalie for nothing.
She's a waitress in one of the parties. But it's, again, just a really sort of clear, quick statement of somebody who really wants to just put an outfit on and get there.
Well, Dylan's character has a little tramp to her, you know, a little free loving and free living.
She's so cool, and she's just tough, you know, and she's sexy. I want to shake.
I I'm more a flower child in a relaxed way. So what I've done is done taking things like an old Spanish shawl and done some vintage work. Colors are softer as opposed to some of the other angels. Lucy's character is more cosmopolitan, international.
She's high class. She wears a lot of black in the movie.
Her palette is a much stronger, darker, a little more serious. And we use a lot of very form-fitting leather on her, fitted leather jackets.
And Bosley.
Yeah, we sort of found a time frame, which I think was the late 60s, early 70s, and patterned all of his clothes after that. He wears some open collar shirts, mock turtlenecks, which are great. Again, a very sort of late 60s kind of vibe.
They're guys that found a look at some point in their life and stuck with it. It may never have really existed, but it's definitely not coming back. It may have only worked for an hour. It's sort of like out of a 1964 Playboy magazine.
Well, I've tried to give an elegance to the whole thing, and it's a choice of color and fabric. Cameron has an elaborate beaded dress. It's a pale blue chiffon dress, totally studded with clear stones. It was done in sort of the 50s movie musical style. One scene, the girls are attending elaborate gala. This, again, is a beaded dress of Lucy Liu's. The skirt just breaks away. So it's been fun to try to design things in several different modes, both elegant and fashionable and still ready for action.
And what's your favorite outfit that Alex wears?
The car outfit.
With the red, white, and blue stars?
That's my favorite.
You like that
one? Oh, yeah.
I've come undone. There's a lot of disguises. We just have a great time at being different people.
This is one of our disguises.
So that's been a great deal of fun. We did things like rock bands and belly dancing costumes. At one point, they're in a Moroccan restaurant, Swiss Miss Yodeling.
That's the fun of the movie. You know, it's like, what was that? Why are they dressed like that?
It's not every day that you get to do contemporary clothes mixed with a lot of theatrical kind of things, which is what this show has been all about.
I think you mean crazy bitch.
There's no question that the biggest change in movie making over the past, 5 to 10 years has been visual effects. The rapid changes that have taken place recently with the digital age is just amazing.
Most of the time, they're planned out way in advance. McGee was very careful to plan most of this out.
We thought it was going to be about 140 shots originally, and as the script evolved, the shot list grew, and we did about 600 shots. We have a satellite shot in orbit over the Earth. We have a lot of CG missiles, a lot of screen burn-ins, you know, where you'd see a laptop or, you know, video screens.
There was a tremendous amount of wire removal work in a lot of the fights.
So it was sort of the full gamut of effects stuff. Opening shot, McGee said, I want to start with the Columbia logo, push into the clouds, have a plane coming right towards camera, go in the window of a plane, toward the end of the plane, then you see LL Cool J. He goes all the way up and he sits in first class. Then he wanted Cool J to grab this guy, go to the emergency door, pop the door, and fly out, tumble out past the plane, and that would be one shot.
It's all one shot, but it isn't. I think it's actually three shots within the airplane.
In, come out, and we're in this thing right here. We're tight on LL's face. He sits back into it.
Not to mention the airplane was created in a computer, and then of course there's the Columbia logo, which just normally just gets cut onto the head of your movie.
Going out of the door, that was the hardest part.
Earn your wings.
Get out! We did an animatic, just a very simple 3D animatic, almond-shaped heads with no features generally. And it really is just to get the feel and timing and so forth down. And it pretty much was very much like the animatic. It pretty much followed the design of the animatic, and that was the whole idea.
It is creating one shot out of three or four.
Well, with the racers, we had to build cars that could crash. We had to build cars that were shot off a bridge. So we had to bring the cars in here. We had to develop a system to actually shoot the cars. We had a cannon that we built that we used to shoot the car literally 200 feet. So we could shoot it over the bridge, getting it up over the guardrails and this, that, and the other thing, and come up with a pretty nice shot.
I just wanted so many bullet hits in there. I'm like, Paul, I just want you there for weeks just loading in all these bullet hits. I want so many bullet hits. I want the Swiss cheese. I want it to just be riddled with bullets.
So we had to rig the exterior of this Airstream trailer with some 2,000 bullet hits.
I love that he just goes that far.
So I did a few animatics. I'd show him, we'd sort of work it out. And he was shooting at the time, so I'd bring it out on a laptop. We had to shoot the actor separately.
The background plate was actually made up of three different plates. The camera would get to a point and then stop because, you know, they'd have lights in the way. And then they'd move all the lights and then shoot the next bit. There's a split around Kelly here, and then there's a split in the column here.
It's quite a bit of work on that shot.
There was two parts of the helicopter. See, there's a live action part of the real helicopter flying around. We just did a lot of rigging and had guys hanging off it and all, stunt people. Then we had a mock-up helicopter we put on stage, and we actually hung a full-size Huey helicopter on the stage.
This thing weighed, you know, 3,000 or 4,000 pounds.
I had to create an environment that looked like it was lit by a real sun, and I had to bring other elements in, like the proper direction of the wind.
We had the wind machines and this, that, and the other thing, and did their fights and all that stuff on it.
I shot background plates in VistaVision in a large negative format so I could move around later if need be without compromising the image quality of the background. Then it was even taken outside. We get these sort of broad shots of the girls swinging.
And so the wires are removed first off the plate, and then take another shot where there's real helicopter blades, spin them, and then add reflections into the windows, add the shadows from the rotors, again from that same element.
That was a chunk of work.
It's just great when you get people together who are just, they want a challenge, they want to push further, they want to do stuff they've never done, and when you just, you know, kind of pull up your sleeves and focus, just go Lombardi, get in there and make it happen.
The explosions that we did, we blew up what was the Townsend Agency. We did that over in the back lot at Universal.
Where I was just like, Paul, you know, more is more. You know, I mean, when something blows up, I want you to blow it up.
Well, how did he put it?
I want to get banned from this location. I want these people screaming. I want, you know, people furious with us that we pushed it way too far. Push it, push it, push it. Raise the bar. Bigger, more explosions, more gas, more fire, more bullets, more bang, more, you know, volume, more noise.
I said, oh, okay.
I'm telling you, they're still talking about that out in Toluca Lake. The shockwave of that was something out of the day after.
Then we blew up the main castle. And that was a big structure. It was some 40, 50 feet tall.
He just went bonkers. I mean, people heard that for like 30 miles in every direction.
It looks like it was done as a digital effect, and in reality, it's a real shot. We actually had three extras jumping. The explosion got so close to them that I was really concerned for them, but nobody was injured. It looks great.
I love a guy who just goes crazy and never really grew out of that adolescent phase of loving to blow shit up. I'm right there with you, Paul. We had to shoot the Chinese alley scene, for example, you know, in tiny little bits and pieces. You'd set up for, you know, an entire shot that really just got, you know, a moment. And I think it's interesting if you look at them bit by bit and piece by piece and you see it with the harnesses intact and you can see what the girls were subjected to in order to get it to look right. And then ultimately you go in there and you take out the wires and you get the finished result.
We did a Marco Polo scene that was going to take place at the party where Bosley was in a battle of wits with the Roger Corwin character.
But let's see if you can survive a test of intuition and judgment.
And it was going to take them to playing Marco Polo.
Marco. Crazy enough to make you do something drastic, huh? Marco?
Polo!
Gotcha!
You got him first!
You little blonde lot! That's a do-over!
No!
I call interference.
No interference, you're in.
Listen, Reg, let's settle this mano a mano. Japanese style!
Ultimately, it wasn't exactly right for the pacing of the party, but I mean, we had a great time shooting it. Dylan and Natalie, Drew and Cameron's characters, are breaking into Red Star. We had it that when they were at the door, you know, of the mainframe room, they got interrupted by Roger Corwin, Tim Curry's character, coming around the corner. And they made a run for it, and you see, you know, that they almost go into the ladies' room, but then they end up going to the men's room, realizing they're dressed as men.
Dude, we're supposed to be guys.
You're right, I'm sorry. Lo and behold, Corwin comes in to relieve himself, and of course, you know, our two angels can't resist. They got to go over and, you know, play with him a little bit, and they have some fun doing it.
So have you seen the new Quartzian processor?
Just got a peek at it.
It's so tiny, don't you think?
It's amazing how equipment that small could function.
It's all right.
Oh, no.
Thinking the same thing, but then I guess it just goes to show that size doesn't matter, right?
That's what they say.
We had a scene that showed what happened that night. They stayed together and you know, decided to have their shake and bake moment.
Go, because you're a client, and thank you, Mr. Knox. Remember to lock the door behind me.
In the end, I just thought it was a little more elegant just going right from I Want to Shake, which seemed to speak volumes, than getting ready and right into the montage of the evening with the other characters.
I got an idea! Go!
Do it!
It's faster, harder, tougher, cooler, funnier, sexier. For the sequel,
We've taken it to a different level, a higher level.
I want to feel the speed. I want to feel the danger. I want to feel the sexiness. I want to feel the excitement.
The excitement speaks for itself. The action is all the way there.
Make the action bigger. Make the fight scenes more exciting, more dynamic.
It's exciting and it's fun and, you know, you get to kick ass. Taking danger, bottling it, and putting it, you know, on film.
If every frame isn't special, then why are we doing it?
We really get thrown around in this one. There's no way that you're not going to get bruised. It's just impossible. It's just, it's going to happen.
The stunts that they've done, it's going to be fantastic.
Ready, and punch, elbow.
See where the blinking triangle lights are that are moving?
Yeah.
They're installing the bleachers and everything.
Well, the fun thing about this movie is you get to do everything.
Motorcycles and surfing.
Skydiving, boating, flying through the air.
I had never welded before, and here we are. We're strapped on full gear.
This whole production is like a flotilla of, you know, trucks and gear and people.
Every single day is an absolute joy and a challenge and an adventure.
It's one of those movies you're gonna watch it over and over again.
And I think the audience is just gonna be captivated by it.
The Angels can do anything, anytime, anyhow. It doesn't matter, they can do it.
Hey, Charlie, these girls are crazy.
There's a little something for everyone.
Bosley!
What's happening, Angels?
I'm having a serious habit problem.